Hey everyone, it's Justin again, and thank you so much for joining us today. Now, before we get into this video, make sure that you've already seen the pre-video for this lesson. It's called Aerospace Engineer, and it's meant to give you some important background information about what we're going to be talking about today. Have you ever heard the expression, "Houston, we have a problem"? That's actually a quote from a movie called Apollo 13 that was based on a real space mission that almost ended in disaster. The astronauts had to work closely with mission control on the ground just to be able to survive and return to Earth safely. So, who are those people? Whose job is it to help astronauts out? Well, today we're going to meet someone who works at Mission Control at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas. Leslie Hammond is currently a robotics systems manager at NASA, and she used to be a flight controller responsible for the robotic arms used on space shuttles and the International Space Station. Get ready to learn all about her job of literally controlling robots in space as we learn the ups and downs and what it takes to be a flight controller. I am super excited to introduce you to today's guest. Leslie Hammond is a space robotics engineer that worked as a flight controller who helped control the robotic arms used on space shuttles and the International Space Station.
Hi, my name is Leslie Hammond, and I am currently the Deputy MSS System Manager. MSS stands for Mobile Servicing System, which is the robotic system supplied by the Canadian government on the International Space Station. I was a specialist on robotics on both space shuttle and space station. And there are two backroom positions for each of those disciplines.
We've already learned about the International Space Station from our pre-video, but let's learn a little more from the expert.
The International Space Station is a collaboration with the United States, the European Space Agency, the Canadian Space Agency, the Japanese Space Agency, and the Russian Space Agency. All those folks got together and planned out a scientific laboratory that orbits the Earth in what's called lower Earth orbit. And every 6 months or so, a crew is traded out so that at any given time, there can be from 3 to 9 people on board the space station.
Leslie and other mission specialists at Mission Control make it a point to get things squared away before the mission starts, but things don't always go as planned.
If, you know, one of the joints break and you have to figure out how to get the arm in a safe position, but you can't use one of the joints, there are 7 on the space station arm, you have to figure out how to get from where you are to where you need to be in a different manner than you had originally planned.
Here, Leslie gives us an example of how she controlled the arm to fix problems during space missions.
And I was in the support positions, and the door to the drag chute, which is used during landing, fell off during launch. And so they wanted us to figure out if there was any way for the robotic arm to be maneuvered into a place to go look at that, to see if they could see what kind of damage that did to the other part, if the chute was still there. So I had to figure out, one, could we even see it if we pointed it there? And two, what aspect of it we could see. So I provided views to the teams that were specialists of the structure to say, here's what we can see, and they could use those to determine what they needed to with regards to the problem.
Before Leslie and her team maneuver the robotic arm in space, they perform ground simulations to test and prepare for the tasks they need to solve various problems. These simulations will have different views, angles, and software that mimic what happens in real life. So how did Leslie become such an integral part of space missions? What were her interests and aspirations growing up?
I think maybe when I was a very small kid, I might have wanted to be an astronaut. The more I learn about what they have to do, the less I want to be one, because, I mean, it is a dangerous job and it requires you to get yourself into some situations that I don't think I'd be comfortable with. When I was growing up, I lived in South Florida, which is about an hour and a half's drive to Kennedy Space Center. And so I watched almost every rocket that went up. I watched the space shuttle, and my dad was a fan of space too. So he kind of helped that along.
Leslie's dad loved to create things that were interesting and a little out of the ordinary. Here's Leslie with her dad in the flying garbage can lid he invented. He coined it the Garbage Can Lid 1, or the GCL1 for short. He attached a propeller on top and little flaps all around it, and he actually made it fly.
And then I got to fly in my uncle's airplane once, where he took me up and he actually had an aerobatic airplane, so he did the, you know, the cool like barrel rolls and stuff like that. We only did one thing, but it was still very exciting for me. And my dad had studied aeronautical engineering, but didn't finish his degree, but talked about airplanes and rockets and all that kind of stuff a lot. And after that plane ride, I wanted to be an aeronautical engineer too.
Her dad's interest in engineering was a major influence in her life. He built a car with Leslie and her sister. Here she is working on the engine. In school, Leslie loved science and math, and she knew that she had to excel at those courses in order to become an engineer. To become a flight controller, STEM courses are critical.
Your science, your math classes are critical to not just whatever course of study you want to take in college, be it engineering, physics, any of those require a lot of science and math. But the reason that they hire people with those types of degrees to do flight control is not because of specific knowledge you gained learning to be an engineer, but that you have the logical and critical thinking required to learn the system that you're going to be dealing with, whatever one it is.
After high school, she decided not to go to college right away. Instead, she went into the Air Force.
I did well enough that I probably could have gone straight to college, but I actually made a pause and went into the Air Force for a couple of years. And I was an aircraft mechanic as an enlisted member of the Air Force. And I worked on a tanker airplane. So that gave me kind of a technical background that was practical.
So what traits are necessary to become a flight controller?
You need to be able to listen to 3 or 4 different conversations at a time and be able to pick out what's important to you. You don't necessarily have to be an outgoing person, but you have to be assertive enough to, if your system has a failure in it, there's chatter going on in the what we call the flight loop, which is the flight director and anybody else he might be talking to. You need to be able to break in and have the confidence to do that, to say, I've got such and such happening in my system and I need some sort of action either from the ground or from the crew. So if you like checklists, that's a really good person to be a flight controller, because you pretty much live off of those. The crew does, as well as the ground.
And there's something to be said about having years of experience. Once you get used to certain situations, you can handle them with confidence.
The Space Station Arm, as it gets older, has had problems come up. I guess I'm more accustomed to that now, so it doesn't feel as gut-wrenching. It's kind of a hesitation of, oh, what is that?
This job requires a lot of sitting at a computer, reading materials, manuals, and using computer simulations. But it's not all just sitting at a desk.
That, I think, is one of my favorite things about the job that I had, is that it's not just sitting at a computer. That's what I do a lot of now. But there, I was also a crew instructor, so I got to teach astronauts how to fly the arm, too. That was also fun. But learning the system involves going to classes that the astronauts take. So you learn hands-on type things.
Astronauts also have to prepare to fix things on the outside of the space station. While they're still on the ground, they prepare by going to a giant swimming pool known as the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. They enter the water wearing spacesuits, and the environment simulates zero gravity situations so they can practice doing repairs using the tools they'll have in space. What does Leslie expect the future to hold, both in space exploration as well as careers in space engineering?
Commercial vehicles are being introduced. So now, instead of just having the government do everything with regards to flight control, you have private company and entities with their own mission control centers who are operating their vehicles. And so that's the changes that I see.
Be sure to check out the PDF that accompanies this lesson to find out more info about the outlook for job growth and the median salaries for aerospace engineers. That about wraps it up for this video. I once again want to thank our interviewee, Leslie, for her time and expertise. It is not every day you get this much insight into what it's like working at NASA. And as for me, I just want to learn more. I think I'm going to do my own research on the space station and robotic arms and space missions in general. That might be a fun thing for you to do too. There is so much more to discover. See you next time. Hey.